I'd like to call to order. This is very important. September 27th, 2016, Shelburne Selectboard meeting. Obviously, this is an evening of great importance where we all wear team affiliation. So, I'm going to give everybody a chance to talk about their team affiliations during select board comments. So first, consider approval of the agenda. Does anyone have any additions or comments?
Not. I'm good.
Moved to approve by Colleen, seconded by
I'll second it.
John. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, great. Next, consider select board minute meetings. Let's do them one at a time. First, September 12th. Anybody have any comments?
So there should be in front of you. Control September 12th.
Wait a minute. I've got the 13th. I've got September 2nd.
16. 14th.
And I got a September 20th, which that's not on the list.
Sorry, which. 20th is on the. Yeah, well, 20th should be. What's the, which one was the 12th? That was the Monday.
That was the Monday.
All right, why don't we do that one at the next meeting?
Okay.
You seem to have displaced it. Let's do September 13th. Anyone have any comments about it?
No.
Hearing none, someone like to move to approve the minutes? Moved by Colleen, seconded by
second.
Jerry. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? September 15th.
That was Colleen's party.
That was Colleen's party, yes.
And just that it was the third bullet, just that it passed 5-0.
Yeah, I'll change that, 5-0. All five members of the board were there.
Yeah.
Okay.
We have the, okay. What about the 14th, too?
Yeah.
We'll get to that.
Okay, move to approve, September 15th.
15th?
15th?
Yeah,
okay.
15th.
Second.
Moved by Colleen, seconded by Jerry. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Josh, did you vote?
I'm sorry, please tell me where we are.
Yeah. Looking at the minutes of September 15th.
Have we done 12?
No, we didn't have 12.
We didn't have 12 in our packets. We
okay.
We've done 13 okay. And 15.
All right, let's move on. We'll just,
so 14, you want to do 14?
Same. Let's do September 14th. The typo. All right.
Move approval.
Move to approve by Jerry.
That was the ethics seminar.
Yeah, the ethics seminar.
Seconded by
second.
Colleen, any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
And I abstain, I wasn't there.
Okay, next is September 11th.
16th.
16th.
September 16th.
And there's definitely a typo on 5. It says 8:45 p.m. Obviously, it was 8:45 a.m. I'll okay. Change that.
And concluded at 8:40 a.m. in a couple of places. Yeah.
This is a Friday morning meeting.
Before, you also have the a.m. p.m. thing on
yep.
Item 4.
Yeah,
yep.
I'll make that update before it's signed.
Okay, with those changes, someone like to move to approve?
So moved.
I have some comments on the 16th. This is, let's make sure I got the right one here.
You weren't there.
Right. Okay, I just want to make a comment on it, if that's right.
Well, we're approving the minutes.
I know. I have a comment.
Comments on these minutes?
Yeah.
I don't know if they're accurate or not, if you weren't there.
Well, I can make a comment afterwards if you'd prefer.
Well, yeah, why don't you make a comment during your select board comments?
Okay, that's fine.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Josh, are you abstaining?
I'm abstaining.
Okay.
Okay, next are minutes of September 22nd.
That was the Stormwater Summit.
Stormwater Summit. Someone like to have any comments?
Move approval.
Moved by Jerry, seconded by?
Second.
Colleen. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain. I'm abstaining.
Abstain.
I wasn't there.
Okay.
And then 20,
and the 20th?
20th, that's the library design shred.
Right. Any comments? Someone like to move to approve?
Move approval.
Moved by Jerry, seconded by Colleen. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
And I abstain.
Abstain? One abstention, okay.
Okay.
Next up, citizen participation and public comments. This is the time in our agenda where if someone has something they'd like to bring to our attention over which this board has jurisdiction, that is not on tonight's agenda. We welcome hearing from you. Anyone? Colleen!
This isn't part of this, but I would just like to thank the board and Peter and Joe and everyone for a wonderful retirement party. The only downside, there were so many people that I didn't get to see or talk to everybody, but it was a wonderful night and I appreciate all the accolades and the everything that I received. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Colleen.
Well deserved.
Maybe we should just have another one.
Yeah.
All right. Select board comments.
Tony.
Oh, Tony. Oh, yeah. Sorry.
Thanks. It's okay.
You look
if I sit
great
down.
Tonight.
Thank you.
Wait
thank
for
you.
It. You know what everyone goes to wait for?
Yeah.
Even deep.
After the last meeting, is this on?
Is that working?
Is this on?
Yes.
Hello? Is this on?
Yes.
Okay. After the last meeting, when we were talking about the Bay Road improvements and other matters, one of the things that I was hearing a lot from the audience was nobody told me. And I went home and actually wrote an email to Jerry talking about my thoughts with it. And I just wanted to share it with the rest of the board in case he hadn't shared it with you.
Okay.
Not the whole thing, but I just wanted to read part of it. And I have a suggestion.
Sure.
Okay. The discovery that private property owners didn't realize projected bike paths or property improvements on Bay Road were slated to affect their property should be a loud wake-up call for the town and its various committees. It can't be assumed that property owners have been notified as they should be. Notices in the paper or the town bulletin board and front porch forum apparently aren't enough when private property is at stake. And I want to just say, I know that the town is doing everything that it is supposed to do, and that you all and the administration wants to have open transparency and so on. So I'm not pointing the finger at you. I'm just saying I think there are cracks in the system, that it's becoming a theme. And I have a suggestion for how to correct that. So when, in the case, when a developer comes to planning and zoning identifies the properties that are affected and they are sent notices and they are made aware of the meetings so that they can have their voices heard, that they have a chance to attend. And I would like to suggest to the board and the town administration to consider doing the same thing, even if it's a committee, because the committee is appointed by the select board. They are part of the town governance. So it isn't enough to assume. I'm shocked at how many people just on my street that I found out. I'd say half of the households don't participate in front porch forum. So it's, you know, people really have to be paying attention and be checking in with the town all the time to find out if something is affecting them. So it would seem just to be a courtesy. It would cut down on a lot of time if people were involved in the very beginning instead of at the end, when, you know, it's pretty much at the 11th hour to say, whoa, you know, what's going on? So it's just a suggestion. It would seem that planning and, you know, administration could just send out a quick notice, just letting people know that there is a meeting, and probably you'd want to say something to the effect of not to call with questions, but to wait and come to the meeting.
Thank you, Tony. Yeah. Anyone else have any comments?
I have something.
Bill Supple, would you please identify yourself?
Bill Supple, 239 Pearson Drive. Two quick things. One is, you know, I don't know if this is old news, but it'd be nice if you guys said the Pledge of Allegiance, since you have a flag and everything here. You know, I don't know if you've been there and done that. This way, when we start these meetings, it's kind of we're all on the same team, you know, and you are elected officials, and it would be a nice thing to do, especially in today's climate. Secondly, you know, I was reading the town plan, yes, and there might be some interesting interpretations of that document, and one is whether it affects existing structures in town, or whether it should be, whether it's intended for the development of new lands in town. And one thing that struck me with this whole primitive path and the bike path mandate that we want to be a connected town is that it's really, I don't think the town plan ever intended, the crafters of the town plan ever intended to retrofit existing neighborhoods with bike paths. A good example would be, you know, if you're selling your house, and a home inspector comes in and your house is 100 years old. Well, obviously it's not up to code electrically, but it doesn't make it a bad or unsafe structure. So you wouldn't rip out all the electrical work because it's not up to code. It's still functional. Likewise with people who live in cul-de-sacs, we live in cul-de-sacs because that's what we want. If we wanted to live in a broken cul-de-sac with a bike path, that's where we would live. So, you know, just food for thought, you know, rereading the town plan with its intent, I don't think there is a mandate for connectivity applied to existing neighborhoods, only new neighborhoods when you can plan it appropriately. That's it.
Thanks, Bill.
Yep.
All right, anyone else? All right, select board comments. Who would like to go first? Josh?
Yeah, sure. I guess I have three now. First of all, I'd like to recognize both Colleen and what we expressed to her on her party. But just as much, the charrette that the library group put on and the stormwater summit, I think we're a great example of our community working together with or without the select board to really solve or at least address issues for the town. And that gives me a lot of confidence about the things we can really accomplish. So I really applaud their efforts and think they were both very well done. Second, with regard to the September 16th meeting, I just wanted to note for the record that the warning for this special meeting was only to confirm the selection of a new town clerk and did not include an agenda item for an executive session. So when it was scheduled, I said it was unlikely I could be available at the selected date and time, as adding a new agenda item that day resulted in a decision which committed the town to additional litigation and legal expenses. I would have preferred to have participated in that discussion. If I had known in advance that this important topic would be considered, I might have considered alternatives. And I regret that this was not the case. Thirdly, I just wanted to pass on an observation and a request by a town resident that she's concerned that minutes of select board meetings aren't being posted expeditiously, and requests that they get posted within the required time period. So that's it.
You want to talk about team affiliation? You were out of the room when we
yeah.
talked about that.
Oh, well, I can don my important thing. And not being an original Wisconsinite, I sort of had spent many years there. I have acquired, and it there is a spirit, and so go Pack, go.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That's our first team. Uh-huh. John, you got something?
Yeah, I guess a couple of things. I would second the comments about Colleen, and I will say again, those are your time and all the tribute was well deserved, and it's a beautiful thing for a long-standing employee to be celebrated the way that happened, and couldn't be any more perfect. And I think it's a real tribute to the town and just the reach that you've had in this community and helping everyone that's basically here. So I think it was a very special evening to be part of, and I think about it often. So you don't get to do that very often. So I would say that's was quite appropriate to do that. I will say that many of you or all of you probably know that I'm a Bostonite and was born in the city. It's in my DNA, and will never disappear. So in tribute, or in my small way of my understated way of making comment, I've given you some display of some of the things I follow professionally as sports. Just one piece that's very hard to see, but it's a little thing like this. It's a memento of the last game in the original Boston Garden. And I was there. I've kept it in its original packaging. It was April 21st, 1995. And so I obviously have been on the scene for quite a while down there. I went to Boston College, did a master's degree there, and became a follower of their football team. So I have a soiled football cap, wool, the old school style, that type of thing. But that's, kind of where we're at. And we have some jerseys. I would just like to celebrate David Ortiz, his final year. He's doing his first of three games in New York City tonight. So we will see where that takes us. But it's been a lot of fun over the years following all of this. And I just want to say one more thing about sports, and then I'll be quiet. I think we should all be very proud of what CVU football has done. They're 3-0. The boys have worked very hard to attain that. Their game against Essex was outstanding. I followed it from my trip in Europe, and it was just amazing to see and hear that. So I think we should again be proud of our local affiliation with that school. So that's what's on my mind today.
Thank you, John.
Sure.
So let's graduate to Colleen.
So, Colleen, all I wanted to say is I already thanked you and talked to you independently. But just to tell you that I just feel lucky that I happen to be on the select board when you happen to retire, because I'm sure there's many other select board members in the past years that feel the exact same way as everybody sitting up here. The library strat was a huge success. We had a great turnout, lots of great ideas. And thank you to everybody who showed up, and both physically and mentally to help prepare and plan. Yankees, thank you to Ty, my 18-year-old, who helped contribute to our decorations. The only sports team that I own more paraphernalia for is CVU. And I kind of regret, Diana, that I didn't do the same thing, because I could have been head to toe, blankets, socks, the whole thing. Anyway, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Colleen. Jerry.
Second, all the comments about the events of the period of time since we last met, not the least of which was a phenomenal display of commitment and resolve on the parts of the first responders and fire department to the tragic loss of the structure at Shelburne Farms. And when you add it all up, it's quite an quite a great deal about a community, you know, which in my mind, of course, is TOPS. And apropos that, my affiliation on display is the number one team playing college football for some time, probably for some time to come. And while I can appreciate Gary waiting until last, and that's not a reflection on the Yankees' performance, I appreciate my colleague John's display of Boston memorabilia, not the least of which a Red Sox hat. We share a passion there. But I want to repeat, for those of you who may not be familiar, this is an Iowa partisan sitting here. Right. It used to be a pretty decent football team, but it's having some problems with grade school opposition this year, and so we'll see. But in any case, I think this was a fun idea, a great idea. Maybe we can do some more things like this, if not Halloween, then toward the holiday season. And I congratulate Joe for inspiring it, and for Gary for being overboard.
Well, it's my turn now, and thank you, Jerry. Boston, I appreciate your caps. The Yankees have 27 world championships. There are 27 caps and helmets over there. I have 170 at home. I just bought 27. It's important to recognize high school sports. I used to coach the Proctor Phantoms. Of course, the New York Yankees. I'm not sure how you're going to tell. For 9 years, I hosted Lake Monster players. One of whom is playing for the Oakland A's right now. Bruce Maxwell. And then, of course, went to three schools, 3 degrees. Bowling Green Falcons. Nate Thurman, one of the greatest basketball players of all time, went here. And then, a shirt I might have worn 600 or 700 times. So opening day, 48 opening days I've been to Yankee Stadium, approximately 1,000 games. And then, I'm a family man. My granddaughter is a synchronized swimmer at Lindenwood University, outside of St. Louis. My daughter just got her
meeting's over.
University of Michigan. And I have a present for Jerry. College football preview. And I direct your attention to the cover picture of a player from the University of Michigan.
Oh, Wolverine. Wolverine, that's the last time you're going to be on the front
line. And I'd just like to, and I've carried this picture in my wallet every single day since August 3rd, 1979. Thurman Munson died in Glen Clark, August 2nd, 1979. He will always be the captain. He is captain forever. All right. Next up is our town Iowa manager's report.
All right. All right. So oh, I'm coming with the town manager's report. I'll try to take care of the real business here first. So the last select board meeting, the board approved the special town meeting bond vote for the Spear Street water line. All those warnings and requirements have been posted. We will do more than just the legal required. We will be getting quite a bit of information out, both through the Shelburne News, Front Porch Forum, and I know we'll do our best to get out to as many people as possible about the bond vote, what that would mean for water users, and the reason for it, and onward. So that vote will be on November 8th. Second, again, Tony's comments were appropriate, and staff is gonna double, triple, quadruple down on our efforts to do better outreach. And upcoming, and I don't have the dates here, but I will get those out, there's gonna be a follow-up to the Bay Road study that we're doing now, where we do kind of one of those design shreds like we did at Shelburne Vineyard for the Southern Gateway. And there's also going to be a follow-up to the Southern Gateway, where those consultants reveal some of the plans that they developed from the shred. For both cases, especially the Bay Road, we'll be doing direct mailings for people who are affected, you know, John's neighborhood and others who go on the Bay Road. And like Tony said, we're going to do better in terms of reaching out to people. She's absolutely right about that. So those will be coming up in the next month. We also received on Thursday or Friday our first solar array application since the board adopted the new ordinance, which Jamie Hines did quite a bit of work on. So the select board will hear that or review the application on October 11th. It is for a solar array that will be located at Shelburne Farms. I would like to schedule a site visit. I don't think a quorum of the board has to be there, but I'm certainly not opposed to it. I think it would be a good decision for there to be a site visit. October 5th seemed to be getting some traction, but I guess I'm looking to the board to, if not confirm that now, I'd like to confirm that by the end of the week so I can post that and make sure that both Shelburne Farms and the owner of the array would be present at the site visit as well. All right, so I'll post it. I'm not sure yet, but I'll figure out time and I'll post that. There'll be a publicly warned meeting and we'll do a site visit.
4 o'clock or something like that.
Yeah, either noon or four or something like that.
Yeah, four,
right. We'll go for four.
You know, afternoon would be good for me. So
right.
Anytime.
4 p.m.
Like 1 o'clock or
1 o'clock.
1 o'clock or after?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. All right, and as you can see, a lot of people here know that I was born and raised in Iowa City. I've been in Vermont for a while. This is certainly home now, but my heart is still black and gold, beats black and gold for the Hawkeyes, and that's who I'm representing. This was a brainchild of Jerry and I think trading some pretty snarky emails during watching some Saturday football games, and the result was, well, we should have some event like this at a select board meeting. So it is a lot of fun. I also want to return to Jerry his hat. He left his Yankees hat, as you can see, after the ethics training, and I wanted to make sure to return his hat. So here you go, Jerry. It might be doctored. Thank you.
Thanks, John, for covering my back.
Oh, I'd just also like to let everyone know about the team thing. Joe and his wife, Heather, it's like James Carville, Mary Matlin.
Yeah, yeah.
Different ends of the spectrum. Joe's a Yankee fan.
Right.
Heather is a Red Sox fan. Mm.
Doesn't work out well.
Unbeknownst to Joe, I received a text message from Heather today, which says, "Hi Gary, it's Heather Colangelo. Tell your select board members, dot dot dot, homemade goodies for all who wear Boston gear tonight. I'll be watching." So Joe, your wife sold you out.
And I just want to remind Heather that she cheers for a football team whose quarterback is a criminal. So I just want to leave that out. Okay. Sorry,
it's okay.
Joe.
I think I'm getting all the goodies.
All right. Item is a pleasant item. It's item number 7, our introduction of our new town clerk, Diana Vachon. And so, Diana, if you would please come up, and I'll just give a quick summary. As everyone knows, Colleen Haig has retired, and her last day will be coming up in about 2 weeks. We put together a committee of one select board member, Joe, Colleen, two residents, and our human resource person in town. And I have possibly left someone off that inadvertently.
You got it all.
Tom and David.
Yeah. Tom. David Webster, Tom Little were the two residents. We received 8 highly qualified people. It was very difficult to get board to be interviewed by the entire select board. Our charter provides that when the town clerk retires in the middle of her term, it is the select board's job to appoint a replacement until the next election. So we did our interview process. We chose Diana, and we hope it goes very well for you. Thankfully, Colleen will be staying on for a while, so there'll be some overlap, and we have some magnificent policies, procedures, and practices in place that Colleen has instilled in our town government over the last 35 years. So Diana, please, tell us something about yourself.
Thank you very much. I'm Granny Honored. Colleen has a wonderful legacy to follow, and hopefully with her help, it'll be a fantastic transition. I'm really looking forward to this, and it's important to me to be in service to the public, whether it be health or education or whatever needs to be done. So I'm very excited. Thank you all so much, and see you.
Yeah. Thanks, Diana.
Just right. Want to note that, just reminder that, you know, 35 years ago, Colleen became town clerk in the exact same fashion. It was during the middle of a term, and she was appointed by the select board in 1982. So I said, if all goes well, you know, we'll have Hague Hall and Vachon Villa in 35 years, so she's going to do great.
All right. Next item. Item number 8, consider authorizing construction of a primitive path between Boulder Hill and Pierson Drive as a United States Forest Service Class 3 primitive path. This is an item that came before the select board as long as 18 months, 2 years ago, or a while ago, and it was discussed. It was part of a proposal put forward by the Paths Committee through the Planning Commission, which is going back to the Paths Committee, but this one path was really a separate path and wasn't really intended to be part of that entire package. So we have scheduled this as a hearing to hear from anyone who would like to speak on this. I think everyone here is well aware of this path by now. It is a primitive path. It's not going to be paved. It's 100% on town-owned land. It is not going through any private property. Joe, do you have anything to say on this?
No, I'm sure Mike might have some comments. So I think there was some discussion. I know there was some opposition. I don't know if there's still opposition, but my understanding is maybe some of that has been smoothed out and maybe people feel a little bit better about it. Mike brought this similar proposal to the board a little over 2 years ago, almost 2.5 years ago. And I think, you know, he went back and did some of the you know, public reach out that the select board had asked him to do at that time, and I think he's generated some support, certainly, and you know, here it is back in front of the board.
I'm going to turn it over to everyone, but before I do, I just want to offer my thanks to a couple of people here who have really acted with a lot of class, put a lot of time in, and I'm including Mike Ashew, Mike Regan, Tony Supple, Rocco Antonozzi, Mark Gamble, and there's a host of others. But there was a lot of debate on this. Some of it got a little harsh at times, but we've had several meetings right here. People have gotten together on the outside and have had dialogues, and I believe that has helped a lot. So I just wanted to say a special thanks to all those people and to the Paths Committee, not just Rocco and Mark, but to the entire Paths Committee. You guys do a great job. So, who would like to speak for? Why don't I give the select board a chance, and then I'll turn it over. It's Mike Ashews. I did the proposal, so I'd like to give Mike the first shot, and then Tony, I see you'd like to speak, so anybody on the board have anything they'd like to add?
I'm good.
Intro? No, Mike, you want to say something?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I feel like at this point, a lot has been said. By the way, Burlington Rugby. The rugby team needs to be represented. So, yeah, a lot has been said. I feel like everybody is abreast of what's going on with the trail. It's popularly supported in the neighborhoods. It's entirely on town-owned land. Does not cross wetlands or go anywhere near it. I think it would be a great asset for the community. Many people would like to see this happen. It would be modest in scope, very low impact. It would follow existing social trails, clarify some, remove some opportunities for people to meander out of the way. And it would basically, my whole approach to this has been primarily, or at least largely, conservation oriented. So I think this is a way to conserve that land, to make it low impact, to make sure people are not meandering around and using it in various ways. So I think this is just a good idea. And, you know, I think that everything that's been said has kind of been said, but I hope that everyone agrees. So thank you all. And I would say I'm sorry it caused so much controversy. It was never my intention to cause problems. I was sort of surprised and got kind of caught off guard. But, you know, everything seems to me to have kind of come up positive, and that's the end result that I was hoping for. So I'm positive that this is going to be a great thing. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Mike. Thank you. Tony, then everyone will have a chance to talk if they want. You're next.
Tony Supple, 239 Pearson Drive. We live right next to, off the cul-de-sac, where the path will be entering from Pearson Drive. And I just want to say that I still don't know the details of the path, and I was hoping that there would be a presentation by Mr. Ashew so that we are very clear on what he has in mind. I've heard about things, but I have not heard officially from him what he's planning to do. He has never spoken with myself, my direct neighbor, the people on the end of the cul-de-sac. We were never talked to originally. We still have never been spoken to by Mr. Ashew. So I've heard things about what he's planning to do, and I've seen the original proposal. I heard something about it has now changed. There is a wetland advisory at the end of Boulder Hill Drive that should be considered. It's a Class 2 wetland advisory from the ANR map. There's a lot of issues around this path. That this is the first opportunity that I have had, because I was on the select board and had to recuse myself before when it was being discussed. So it is the first chance that I have had that we've actually now talking about the path. So I know we've only got 15 minutes, but I would just really like to hear more about what the path actually is going to entail. I also do want to bring up the matter of parking in the cul-de-sac. And I want to read something from our town plan that pertains to this. So on page 52 of the town plan, under transportation, it says, this is on the subject of primitive paths, that the town will provide access to the primitive paths from the sidewalk, path, and road system, including consideration of adequate parking as needed. So of course, being living on a cul-de-sac, my concern is that once this map is public, and people want to access it, does that mean that there will be cars parked in the cul-de-sac, which it sounds like they would have the right to be parked there? So this
really does change the private feel of a neighborhood to suddenly, you know, there's public parking right outside your driveway. So that's a primary concern. The other concern that I would like Mike to address, we have many questions about the, I know, I'm it's extremely wet where the entrance to this path is. I mean, it's a pond in the spring when there's runoff and so on, and Paul Gritter should be the first to attest to that. So I've heard that the plan is to just dump gravel there, which would cause it to then back up into our yard. So right now it drains naturally into the woods. It actually drains from the whole street. There's a swale system for the whole street that goes down and then it drains into the woods. So if gravel is put there for this path, you know, that will back it up into not only our yard, but also our adjacent neighbors, the Hollisters. So that's a big concern. We have other concerns too. And I don't know if, do you want me to just go through my other concerns and then maybe, yeah, I know. Okay. I've heard in his original proposal that he said trees, no trees greater than four inches in diameter would be cut. I'm wondering what does he do with the trees and the brush that he does cut? Are they going to chip it? Are they going to leave it in the woods? I'm concerned about the brook that they will be crossing, that they don't divert water from the brook. You know, there is wildlife in the woods that uses that water. And I'm very concerned that we learn the lessons of the La Platte Bridge here for the town. And I'm putting on my ex-select board hat here. Who's going to be liable for this? I mean, you've got volunteers constructing this, you know, cutting down trees. If there's an infraction, if we see something being done that shouldn't be done, I mean, what if they're clearing too wide? So in his original literature, it said 7 to 8 feet, and then I saw something else that said 6 to 8 feet of an entrance. We would like to request that at the cul-de-sac entrance that it not look like a driveway, that it more or less be what it is now, which is a 4 to 5 foot wide natural looking path, and then it opens up once you get into the woods. But I think to try to preserve the look of the neighborhood, that's a concern.
Okay.
Where is the water going to be drained to? That's a question that I have as well.
Thanks, Tony. I'll just give a couple quick answers. Adequate parking, the town plan refers to as needed. There's not an expectation at this time that this path will lead to much additional parking. Cut trees 4 inches in diameter, it is my understanding that is the limitation. The brook, I walked it. I don't see how a path like this will impact negatively the brook. Who's liable? This path would have the same liability concerns as every other town path in town. It would not be any different. The labor by volunteers in regard to your entrance concerns, but this would still be under the supervision of the town manager. So those are a couple of quick things. Sir, if you could please identify yourself.
Yeah, Buell Hollister, 292 Pearson Drive.
Hi.
Hello. I'd first like to just give you this, if you could pass it out. We're the neighbors of the Supples, and
there's only one copy of it, I guess.
Well,
okay.
Yeah, pass it around. It says here, this is for the construction of a United States Forest Service Class 3 primitive path. Now, the definition of primitive was dropped from, if you look at that, the trail class matrix of the U.S. Forest Service, it's listed as a developed, the whole thing on there. I don't see any primitive in there. And if you look at the other thing I gave you, it lists the responsibilities for maintaining the path. I just wanted to point that out. Secondly, this Mike Ashew, he's had 2.5 years.
Yeah, please just speak to us.
Yeah, never once has he come and tried to contact us. Never once in that time. The Supples and us are the two people most directly affected by the path. He has not had the common decency.
Come on, please, 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 I'm going to stop you right there.
Yep.
I will tell you, I have dealt with Mike Ashew. He's a man of integrity. He's honest. And please, let's keep
Well, things. Why hasn't he contacted us then in 2.5 years? Can you explain that?
No, please, all comments are directed to the Select Board pursuant to our rules of procedure.
I'm sorry. Well, if he could answer that to you, why he hasn't contacted us? Do you think that's right? I don't think Tony, he didn't contact you, did he?
Okay.
I mean, it just doesn't seem right.
Wait.
All right, thank you.
Yep.
Does anyone else have any comments? Ken Albert. How are you?
I'm fine. I like your garb. I don't know if I agree with all the teams that are displayed. I didn't know. We moved into Shelburne Heights. We live on 70 Pearson Drive, about six houses down from where the path will start, from the northern, I guess it's the northern terminus of the path. And I guess we moved in 1971. I don't guess. I know we moved in 1971. And from that winter on, we've been using that path. Now, there have been some years when it wasn't used, but on and off, that path has been used by myself, my family, my kids, other family people in the neighborhood. For a while, it was very well maintained and probably had a path that was about 4 to 5 feet wide with all the brush cuts, so you could go all the way from Pearson Drive all the way to where Boulder Hill is right now, and then we used to bomb down that hill in the winter on our cross-country skis. It's a wonderful, beautiful thing that I think will enhance, I think, the well-being of the neighborhood if we don't close it off. Because, you know, do you need a path there? Yes. Is the path there? It's there. It could use a little upkeep. I think it's a wonderful gem to have in our neighborhood. It will allow us in Shelburne Heights to be able to go, without going on Spear Street, we'll be able to go directly to the path on Webster Road. So for us, I think it's rather important that something that's there now and has been there since 1971 and probably before that, because some of the homes in that neighborhood were there 20 years before me.
You mean things happened before you moved here?
Well, the population of Shelburne, since I moved here, by the way, I think it's doubled or more. So things have happened. So there must have been something before I moved here. But that path has been there, and I hope that, you know, that path will continue to be there on what has been land that was not owned by a private party, but owned, at least now, owned by the town. So that's my strong desire.
Thank you very much, Ken.
And if there's a concern about any drainage, hopefully, you know, there is nothing that's done in upgrading the path to where it was before, you know, 10, 15, 20 years before, 30 years before. If there's a concern with gravel, you can easily just put down wooden planks, which is what they do in a lot of primitive paths. So there should be zero impact, any kind of drainage to the neighboring houses. And I think we should adhere to that kind of a guideline.
Thank you. Is there anyone else here who would like to add something? George Chavon, please.
I just have a comment. I came in late, so I didn't hear the beginning of the meeting, but I heard you thanking a lot of people for doing a great job, and then I heard Tony say, hey, we don't know where all the details. So what were you thanking them for? Are there some more work to be done on this path? What?
Actually, the primitive path proposal is on the town website, I understand, right, Joe?
Okay. Okay.
So the details are on the town website.
Okay.
And have been available.
And Tony, you've seen those?
For some time.
You've seen? Yeah.
All right, wait a second.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I'm talking to you. Yeah. I'm talking to you. Well, that's the impression I got. I didn't get here early enough, but it sounds like something has been done, and not everybody understands what's been done.
Okay. Thank you, George. Anyone else? Mike?
Yeah, let me.
Yeah, if you please, you're not forced to, but if you could engage a little dialogue to.
Yes. Well, first, I did knock on George's door, and I did actually talk to him one day coming up the street.
I didn't say you didn't.
No, I know. Just so people know, I did knock on I think it was Mr. Hollister's door, but nobody was home. Okay. And there were people was not able to talk to. And it was a lot of walking. And after a while, there's only so many times you can go back and talk to people again. I tried to talk to people. I did not talk to the Supples, and I'm sorry I did not. I did not think that we were going to see eye to eye on this, and that's maybe my fault. But as I said, things got off kind of on the wrong foot. I was surprised when people were opposed, and it kind of happened the way it did. Regarding the actual structure, I used to do trail building. That was the original inspiration for this. I worked for 7 years for a company doing trail construction in Alaska and Colorado and all around the U.S. I have a lot of training in it. I was a younger man and probably a little more fit, but the principles are still the same. The technique is to use French drains, which allow percolation of water back and forth across the trail. So you would have breaks in the trail with rocks that allow the water to percolate. So that would be in that. And by the way, I walked the trail with Hermit. The trail builder is a guy that does trail building, came out and walked it with me. I know him through trail building community. So we talked about this. The idea is it's called a turnpike. I'm hesitant to use that word. There's no ambition to build a turnpike, but you raise the tread by about 6 inches. You raise the tread. So the tread is the walking part of the trail. That's 24 inches. A standard class 3, put your arms out, and that gives you the width of the corridor. The idea is to cut trees back so you're not getting poked in the eye. Give yourself a little leeway so that you don't have to keep coming back every, 6 months to continue to trim. So the corridor is roughly, that's the width cut back from the tread, about 6 feet, maybe wider. The class 3 specification is a rough specification used by the Forest Service, but those are the general guidelines. Minimal trail construction in terms of using techniques to actually elevate the tread and make it usable for long-term use and be able to sustain the impact. So there's an area at the beginning where if you raise the tread and use some French drains to allow the water to percolate back and forth across the trail, you avoid any kind of issues with drainage problems. There's another area farther down where there's a wet area that something similar has to happen. The brook, I don't think needs anything to get across there. People are able to cross that without any problems. There's an area farther down where I think if we use an older social path that the people from Holly Drive use when they come up, it avoids getting us down near the wetland. So it just cuts off a little bit of the tread. We did walk this back in 2014 and we looked at all of this and it's been discussed and gone through. So all the information that I've just provided, I think, is available in the documents. And I could have done a presentation, but I thought that information was out there and pretty easy to obtain. I think it's fairly straightforward and fairly minimal in terms of the actual work that's going to need to be done.
I think it's fair to say that the difference between what there's there now and the class 3 is
pretty minimal.
It's pretty minimal. Yeah.
I mean, there already is a path there now. I walked it with you 2 years ago. So.
Yeah, and when you get back in there, it's much more recognizable and easy to follow. There are some areas where it should be clarified better and where the trail should be beefed up just a little bit to make it easy to follow.
All right. Thank you, Mike. Anyone on the select board like to weigh in?
No, I'm good.
Good.
I can just say that I'm a Shelburne Heights resident. I've used the path. I can understand some concerns, but I think overall, it would be a great it's a great opportunity for people to enjoy part of our public lands.
Thank you. Jerry, Colleen, you have something you'd like to add?
I think this has been hashed out enough. And as far as thanking anybody, I would just thank Mike for being a citizen who has worked really hard just to try and accomplish something that he felt would benefit somebody other than himself. And, you know, I see somebody else here who also tried to do that, and it hasn't quite worked out, but you know, there was a lot of effort. And it's nice to be able to have somebody who put this kind of effort in and have it come to a happy conclusion. Maybe not for everybody in the room, but for many.
Jerry.
I shared a concern with Joe about the conduct of the labor and its auspices. That's a little bit of a technical issue of liability.
Yeah, I spoke protection. To Joe about yeah. that also. And the plan is that Joe would be supervising any work that's done.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just on that. I mean, you know, it would, the town is liable, and obviously we want to encourage volunteerism, but certainly I talked to our insurance company. We want to make sure that anyone who's doing anything has proper equipment, or, you know, so there's going to be some town oversight. Absolutely. I don't want people out there in flip-flops with chainsaws and things like that. So we're going to make sure that it's done. I don't want to show up on Monday at work and I find out about there's injuries. So we're going to, you know, make sure that we do it accordance to good safety guidelines.
So other than that, my sense of this as it has developed, and I don't share like the history, I think we're here for the common good. And I think if there is gratitude to be expressed, it's probably to the supples and near neighbors who are going to sacrifice in their minds some of their privacy for the common good, and I think we should encourage them to feel and believe that contributions to the common good are probably the most essential of any we can ever make, whether they take monetary form or some other style. And to you, therefore, I express such gratitude.
Thank you, Jerry. Would entertain a motion.
Move to authorize the construction of a primitive path between Boulder Hill and Pierson Drive on town-owned land to the United States Forest Service Class 3 primitive path standards. Any and all required permits will be obtained prior to construction, and a voluntary project leader appointed by the town manager must work with the town manager prior to and during construction to ensure proper safety practices, work conditions, and any other appropriate guidelines are followed.
Moved by Colleen.
Second.
Seconded by Jerry. Further discussion. Just like to say this board has done its best to bring this out in the open and to discuss it and to give every single person an opportunity to be heard. And I think we've done that. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Passes. Motion passes.
Okay.
All right. Next item is item number 9. Consider adopting the Pierson Library Alcohol Policy. Joe?
Sure, I can kick it off real quick. I believe Laura and Ruth are here, so they can pitch in. But
I believe it's the legislature. Passed laws allowing for alcohol use in public libraries, and we thought it might be appropriate for some of the social functions that Laura has been promoting for all ages, also potentially any social functions that might have to do with raising funds for the library, and I believe the trustees are also on board with this. We would be one of the first communities to adopt this, so I know that sometimes we're hesitant about being too far out in front on things like this, but I have talked about it with our insurance carrier, and they're comfortable with our policy, and this would be reviewed by the Library Board of Trustees, you know, in 6 months to see how it's going. You know, I made a comment in my annotated notes that, you know, kind of falls in this weird area because the trustees really have authority over the policies of the library. So in one sense, you could argue, well, they have their ability to adopt this without the select board, and that may be true. On the other hand, the building still is a town building, and I think it would be appropriate for both boards to feel good about this. So I don't think there's any reason not to pass this policy, adopt it. It's a policy, it's not an ordinance. If things don't seem to be going well, we can change it, amend it, or scrap it altogether in the future. But it's been well thought out, and I know the trustees worked hard to put this together as well.
And they already
They approved it. Yeah.
I understand people from Iowa have a lot of experience.
Right.
Ruth, I see you standing.
I'm just standing up here just in case.
Just in case.
All right. In case you'd like to, would you like to say anything about this? And well, if you do, if you could just... Please use the microphone, Ruth Hagerman.
One thing that Jeff said, just make sure everybody's in the same place. So I'm Ruth Hagerman, I'm Library Board of Trustees. So he said this is, I think you said this is a first or an early case. Okay, so that's in Vermont.
Right.
So this is new legislation for Vermont. I did a quick Google this afternoon and came up with Pennsylvania, California, Illinois, Virginia, Maryland, and Halifax, Canada, just on the first page, all have this kind of policy. So in other parts of the country, this is pretty standard. So I just wanted to make sure we're not the first people in the United States.
All right. So thank you. Laura, did you have anything you'd like to add, or are you comfortable? Anyone like to say something? John?
Yeah, I just have, so, you know, in reading it, I'm fine with the overall policy. In under procedure, bullet point number 3, the wording of all that seems a little bit confusing. So I wonder if, you know, maybe you could kind of wordsmith that a little bit to be just crystal clear about what you mean. It just seems, you know, I see regular library hours, and then you have all these designated areas, and it just seems to be a little bit cumbersome, I guess, is the way I would term it. You know what I mean? I think you could scrub all the areas and say designated areas or something like that to make it read a little bit better, but...
Yeah, we can certainly edit that. I think what we were trying to do is reassure people about the children's collection, because when we went out and asked people about this, the first thing everybody said was, well, what about the kids? So we want to make sure people understand that this is not, it would not be in any children's areas.
Yeah,
so
understand.
We listed everything that wasn't, but you're right,
we can
reword that. It's not a problem.
It just seems to me that, and, you know, I think we could pass it as is, as long as we take a note to revisit this at some point to
sure.
do that. That would be my comment. So
okay.
Good. Anyone else have anything? Josh?
Yeah. I guess when I read this, and I assume this would, if we're successful in getting to a new library, then we would redo all of that with regard to spaces. But I think the important thing in the discussions that sort of in the charrette and what's come up, the two things that hit me both in this is community and social. And those are the two things that I think are incredibly important for the library, both the current library and the new library. And certainly anything that can promote people to feel part of the community and the library as a social meeting place, I think is a great idea.
Great. Thank you.
Any, Jerry? Colleen?
Move to adopt the Pierson Library Alcohol Policy.
Second. By Pauline, second by Jerry. Great comment. Any further discussion? Anyone here have anything they'd like to add? Hearing nothing? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay.
Yay, we can drink in the library. We're all coming over after the
like
meeting.
You haven't already.
Raise the glass.
Yeah, after the
item number 10
select board meeting will be over there. Yeah.
Annual CBC report from the Village Dog Park Committee.
So
I'm happy to be here again this year, and to tell you we've had another wonderful year in the dog park, primarily due to incredible efforts on the part of our volunteers. There are daily, weekly, and monthly maintenance chores that our volunteers handle, and probably 95% of the work is volunteer with about 5% some paid help. We are currently a 7-person board, and I understand that that is typical of the town. We would like to add 2 members to our board, because our monthly meetings are an opportunity to really create a sense of camaraderie, and it is during those meetings that people are actually encouraged to step forward and help more. And in addition to adding 2 members to the board, we would also like to be able to actively recruit members. I think unlike many other boards, our board members are often in the park and are meeting the people who use the park, and those people indicate their pleasure with the park and their willingness to volunteer. And so not only do we get to vet the dog and the dog's behavior, we get to vet the human person accompanying the dog. And that is important, I think, to successful working of a committee. So we are interested in that. This year, for the first time, we had a fairly significant incident with 2 dogs aggressively attacking an older dog. One of our committee members was actually there, shoved her fist down the mouth of one of the dogs, was able to pull her fist out, and then she attempted it on the second dog and wasn't quite as successful. She had quite a bit of history with interacting with dogs. It is town land, and anything that happens, of course, is a police issue. We did involve the police, and the owners of the 2 dogs, the aggressing dogs, papers were served, and those dogs are no longer allowed to come into the dog park. Following that incident, we aggressively developed a subcommittee to establish best practices for safety in the dog park, and several components of that, or actually the key component, is education of the people who use the dog park. We have had in-park presentations on recognizing pre-aggressive dog behavior, and we will be having a public presentation arranged through Parks and Rec so that other people who are not using the park at a particular time will also be able to avail themselves of that information. The last comment I would like to make relating to diversity on our committee, we pretty much reflect the diversity of the town of Shelburne, with one exception, age. We did not put a lot of effort into it, but we did try to encourage a high school student to join our board. I am under the impression that there is one high school student sitting on one of the boards here in the town, and we would be interested in making contact with that student board member to see if he could help us make some inroads at the high school level. We would offer a lot to a high school student who sat on our board. We would mentor that student. We would help them in all kinds of ways, spend a lot of time with them, and really help develop their skills. And so I'm asking for the select board to possibly assist us in that matter. So thank you.
Thanks. I think we have, first of all, you guys do a great job. We have several students on our boards now. In the past, we've had others, some who've become full-time members and some who have moved on to other things. But we have people on the Planning Commission, Natural Resources, DRB, don't we have someone with Library now?
Two Library, two. Natural Resources. So we'll work to try to find some.
We'll work with you. But I'm glad you bring it up, because, John, you know, I think it's something maybe you and I could talk sometime about going to CVU, going to Waldorf, and some of the other local schools, because, you know, we want to encourage these student members. And
I think the dog park's also been the benefactor of some Boy Scout projects, too, right?
Oh, absolutely. So the shed there was an Eagle Scout project.
Some really good projects there by the Boy Scouts.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Does anyone have any questions before you go, Jerry?
I have a couple. That was a fantastic report.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, that was really well done.
Thank you.
Thoughtful, complete, and I certainly encourage you to your request to do an escape hatch or a back gate. No. So very often people think of dog parks in kind of a Grandma Moses, you know, context, and don't know that sometimes there can be very unhappy circumstances and events, if not death of pets. And yet it occurs with enough regularity that if you don't have some caring people overseeing it, and that's obvious from your report. I can't say from personal experience, and I'm ashamed I don't have enough of it with what you do here, but it certainly gets communicated in the report. Wonderful. So you're facing on occasion some very serious problems, and I couldn't agree with you more that a back door or a second gate would be a very important development.
Absolutely. It will reduce the congestion that occurs, because when a dog comes in the front gate, typically the other dogs rush the gate, and it can be, you know, quite a bit. So that with the back gate, we can alleviate some of that and keep the dogs.
I've seen that in effect as a structural feature of a fairly large dog park in Greenville, North Carolina, where they mix hounds and pit bulls and other household domestic pets, sometimes not to any dog's advantage. And they have a fairly elaborate, almost like cattle handling facility. Right. And it's very effective, very simple. Once folks who go there understand it, they could quickly exit. And I think that's a great idea.
And we also have another safety area. We have the small dog park area.
Yeah, exactly.
So that is, in, you know, totally enclosed, and smaller dogs do not have to be in with the larger dogs, or a dog that just is a little more timid can go there. So
there you go. Well,
how's the water working there?
Yeah.
The water is working well. We have that shower station out front and the water inside. I mean, it is amazing. It makes me feel guilty sometimes. Our animals have sometimes more amenities than some of our citizens in the United States. But, however, I almost forgot to mention the White Sox. So,
for sale.
Yeah, so I was born and raised in Chicago by a single mother, and I have two sisters. And in the summer, every Wednesday, when the White Sox were in town, my mother would pile us on the L train, and we would go down to Comiskey Park. It was Ladies' Day and free admission. And so that was my first experience with organized sports. And then in grammar school, after school, we had a couple of dirt play fields outside of our school, and the girls would get together, and we would arrange our own pickup softball games, our own umps. We did the whole thing. There wasn't a single parent there. We had no uniforms. The best days.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much. All right. Our next item is
Gary. Oh, Ron.
One quick.
Sure.
So I spoke to a select board member in Colchester, and they're doing the same thing that you're doing, having, we'll call them kids, students on boards, which is a very good thing. He specifically spoke of what Shelburne is doing, having students on the boards, less than voting members. They're voting
That's
adult,
so it's cool.
Thanks, Ron.
Thank you.
See? We're trailblazers. Pretty soon, all select boards going to have team affiliation night.
Number one. Number one. There it is. There's the start.
All right.
Okay.
Yes, please, Fritz, if you could just grab the mic.
Just,
it's for the people on TV.
It's
sorry.
Not on TV.
Oh, don't worry. This thing that Joe has done, but we do have a state representative here, and I caution you that if the enthusiasm that you generate as a result of all of this wonderful stuff that you have goes to the State House, would you believe how many months of man hours we would lose in potentially productive time among our legislatures? And I would urge you to urge her to forget what happens here tonight.
It's a fair comment.
Don't bring the contagion back.
Our next item is got scheduled for 10 minutes, discuss second draft of the capital improvement plan in anticipation of an October 25th public hearing. So, Joe and Peter, why don't you guys
take it over? Second draft, to be honest with you, I don't think it's any different than the first draft, besides this is the second time we're talking about it, and you don't have to now, but obviously it would be really helpful in the next 2 weeks if Peter and I had an idea of where the select board was headed on some of these issues. So I know Jeff McBride is here. We've been working a little bit more on some of the village things, and we'll keep working on that. Josh sent me some questions yesterday or today, and you know, I can go into more detail on that for the next select board packet.
That'd be great.
Besides that, this is really the time for us to hear from the Planning Commission will be reviewing this, and the Water Commissioners also will review their section on October 3rd. So, all right, unless there's questions.
There were just a couple of revisions. I wanted to point those out that came in after we submitted the draft to the Select Board. The Bike Ped Committee, the last bullet point, we did have a project that was in previous plans to connect the Long Meadow neighborhood to Boulder Hill with at least a primitive path there. That was in year 7 last year, and so it wasn't included because it's a 6-year plan, but now that year is in this plan, so the Bike Ped Committee wanted to at least include that. Again, it's in year 6 of the plan, but it's something they feel is worth continuing to plan for, not highest priority, but certainly one that they think should be in there. And then the other one that we had put in kind of a placeholder last meeting, $150,000 for improvements in the town village area for pedestrian and bike improvements. And that's been fleshed out a little bit more now. So the lane narrowing has been revised to $60,000 for the Falls Road and Marcette Road. We would plan on some pilot projects in the upcoming fiscal year. The previous version said we would be doing actual projects in that year. That's been pushed out. Once the pilot projects have been in function for a while, to see how they go. So those are just a couple of changes from the first version that we had. Everything else is pretty much the same. We do have copies here of the entire plan. Again, it is a plan, not a commitment. The only projects we'll be doing are the ones that are budgeted for this year. Any projects in years 2 through 6 are still in the planning stage and would only be funded through our budget process or bond vote.
Thanks, Peter.
I did send out an email to the chairs or the point person to all committee boards and commissions. So I'm just using Cemetery Commission, for example. If, you know, the cemetery commissioners look at the CIP over the next month and say, hey, you know, we should be planning on this, that, the other, we'd like to obviously have those comments back from all of them before October 25th. So,
great.
That's it.
All right.
I'd like the guidance of the chair on this. As Joe mentioned, I went through the plan fairly clearly, and I think I had 16 questions and comments about that. Is it your preference that I go through each of those individually at this point? What process would you like to follow so I can bring them up to the board and the board can discuss them? And I'm not quite sure, then do we then vote on items that would go into the new items or changes in items? Do we vote on the CIP in total? What's the best way to proceed?
So my suggestion, I think I answered all 16 questions. I can put those answers in the next select board packet.
Great.
And then in terms of voting, you know, you'll do that during the public hearing. You'll vote what's in, what's out.
Okay. Right. But I would like to see a little bit more discussion on some of these. I mean, I appreciate the input that you gave back. I'm not sure it's as complete as
I would like, and potentially other members of the community would like.
I think I said in my response to you that I'll sit down and talk to you in more detail about those at any time. I just can't sit down and do a paragraph-long email on every single item, you know what I mean? And, so anytime, you can take the notes and share them.
Yes, but what I'm trying to grasp is how do we make this a discussion process and make sure that the community is involved, the community knows, and the select board has a chance to interact about making decisions one way or the other. I mean, it's very good to provide the information, and I really appreciate that, and I think that's really useful. But I think on some of these things, it also will need to be a discussion amongst the select board about what do we do with these things. And that's the question I'm asking is, what do we see as the best process for doing that?
I'm not sure what else to say.
Well, in the spirit of just like self-education, looking through, you know, the past videos of previous meetings from the budget process last year, mm-hmm. might give you some insight of just kind of the road that we follow and when things are discussed. And that might give you some insight.
Mm-hmm. All right, anyone else have anything else? Ms. Lettuce, if you could please take the mic.
Colleen, to ask, I don't remember the process. And so you said it's all discussed, line item. You said to watch it. I can do that, but I didn't know when.
When what?
When that happens in the process of discussing the capital improvements.
I don't think I understand your question. I'm sorry. Like, when do we start addressing each line item?
When is the conversation? You said it happened and watched the videos from last year. Mm-hmm. So when the whole thing is being discussed, there is a discussion?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, when we start the actual budget process, yep. and we go through everything, yep. that's in the budget.
Yeah.
Yes.
I just didn't remember capital improvement, and you said that, so I jumped up to see.
So let me ask that as a clarification.
Thank you.
On both. I'm not talking about the budget, where the discussion I would like to have is under the CIP, not when we get to the budget part, because I think we talked about, I think, in the last meeting, there are two stages of discussion. There should be two stages. One is determining whether the projects that have been suggested as new items go into the CIP. And then, again, it would be discussed when they actually got funded during the budget process. So my question was, when does the discussion of each of the individual items happen within the CIP project
process? We have
process.
A certain amount of time for our discussions, CIP. Certain members like to get into minutiae. That is not productive. We talk about policy decisions that we make as a board. If you'd like to get into discussions on minutiae, compare different documents that have been presented, then please feel free to go in and visit with Joe Colangelo, who has made himself available to do that. But we do not have time to spend 3 hours every time the capital improvement plan comes up here. If you'd like to make general policy comments, you may do so at any time. You had that opportunity before. This is the second reading. If you wanted to make general policy comments now to talk about an item, you're more than welcome to do so.
Okay.
We had 10 minutes planned for this, and now
I will
use up those 10 minutes.
I can start off. No, it may take more than 10 minutes.
Well, then you're going to be cut off.
Well,
because that's how much time we have.
Well,
and you can get into the minutiae with the town manager and go visit him. This is not a place for you to spend learning on the job.
I appreciate that. My learning is better understanding the process. I think what I've been trying to say is that it's my understanding that policy is made by the select board with an interactive process, that there is discussion. And so when I ask, how do we, if I have questions about items, which I think I would benefit from a discussion from the board, I don't think that's minutia. I think that is policy determination about what do we think are important topic, important items that should be in the CIP. And I believe that there should be time, even though it will take time, to discuss those items. They're not, they're probably, I don't know, Peter, 100 and some, 100, I'm talking about, I have 16, and certainly some of them can be, and Joe has provided good feedback. I don't think all of them need discussion, but I think we're not talking about minutia.
Okay, anyone else have any comments? All right, hearing nothing else, let's move on to item number 13. Consider approving the design review guidelines.
Renewal of the Village Center.
I skipped one? Oh, yes, I'm sorry. 12. Number 12, consider endorsement of the renewal of the Village Center designation. Joe, I assume that's DNC you or? And Dean?
You got to tell about your affiliation.
Yeah, you have to.
So I am here representing
the Hamilton College men's cross-country team, of which I was once a member.
I thought it was the Broadway play.
Well, yeah. I like to say, Jerry, we knew Al before he was cool. And I'll just mention that the Hamilton College men's cross-country team were the 2015 New York State Track and Field Association champions, and they are nationally ranked in the Division III preseason cross-country poll. But the most important thing for me to mention is that you are certainly glad that I am not here representing the varsity streaking team at Hamilton College. Just Google it. Just Google it. World renowned streaking team.
That definitely makes the paper, right?
Okay. There was material included in your packet, and regarding the Village Center designation, I don't have a presentation. I'd be happy to answer questions. This would be the renewal of a designation that the town already has. It was renewed 5 years ago, and was and that itself was a renewal. So this is a process that requires the support of the Select Board. As I indicated in the memo, there's really minimal cost to the town for supporting this designation, and it really amounts to time spent talking at meetings like this and perhaps answering the occasional question. But what happens as a result of the designation is that owners of income-producing properties within the designated area, and there was a map in your packets, I believe, are eligible for certain tax credits and get some priority with different sources of funds. So it's, in a sense, part of the town's overall economic development or economic vitality strategy. I'd be happy to answer questions.
Thank you. We've done this before. Is everyone good, or does anyone want to delve into this more?
No, I just got a quick comment.
Sure.
I mean, I'm very supportive of this and would urge consideration of groups such as that Jeff McBride is representing here tonight that are developing in the Village Center area as resources, if not objects of study, then perhaps even volunteer helpers to address issues.
Okay, I missed whatever it was that Jeff said, so I apologize. I'll have to huddle with him.
Oh, he's part of the Village Safety.
Marset Road.
Now I'm making
that you were with today. That you were really helpful about today.
And he thinks he's faster than you.
He might be. Like I told Joe, you know, if it's over a mile, I'm feeling okay.
I've seen Dean running by my house.
He flies, doesn't he? Yeah.
I'd just like to comment that, you know, this is a good example of, you know, where we could use some public relations to, you know, broadcast this to the town so everybody is aware of it, you know. And I think that, you know, as we listen to people that come and take the time out of their day to come and chat with us, I think these kind of things are important because, you know, this could be passed on as just a piece of trivia and kind of a formality, but, you know, there is some real benefit to members of the community here because of this. So I think that these are good things to do.
If you get past the mic to John.
You called on me?
Yes.
This is an amazing example of collaboration between state government and local municipalities. The impact of financial opportunities that Dean spoke about are tremendous and a really good example. It's not a mandate. It's a good collaborative effort. And sometimes we don't point that out. So you're right. It can be highlighted. Yep. Thanks, John. Right.
Thank you. Anyone else have anything? Not an entertaining motion.
Move to renew the Shelburne's Village Center designation and sign the resolution for Village Center designation renewal.
Moved by Colleen. Second. Seconded by Jerry. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Hey, let's sign this right away so it doesn't get lost.
I should have it.
You have a different one?
Yeah. Well, it's the same thing on town letterhead. That's
okay.
Go ahead.
Well, we'll do it past the...
I have a bunch of things to sign. I'll get you at the...
Never mind.
Okay,
right.
Never mind. All right.
Nice try.
Good. Yeah. Try to help you.
I had
a lot of pressure. All right. Next, item 13, consider approving the design review guidelines.
You saw the presentation from Brandy, what was it, 2 months ago now? Mm-hmm. Everyone was impressed. I don't know if there was any substantial edits since then, Dean.
The title was the title. Modified to match the existing document, which was the suggestion that had been made.
And so if the select board approved them today, they'd be effective now?
It would be, my understanding is that, yes, that if the select board's indicating that this is the new set of design guidelines, that if they replace the old guidelines, that they would be available for use by the DRB.
I didn't print the final version that just had a new name, but it is all online.
Okay. Does anyone have any comments? No. Hearing none, someone would like to make a motion?
Yeah, I'll move approval. That was a really good product.
Okay.
Second.
Jerry moves approving the design review guidelines effective September 27, 2016, second. Seconded by Josh. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, we got it. Item number 14, consider approving the Planning Commission's Vermont Municipal Planning Grant Program application for a village traffic and parking study. Mr. Colangelo.
I'll kick it over again to Dean.
Sure.
And then I might chime in.
Okay. And I prepared a memo, and I'm not certain that this was included in your packets either.
Should
but
be.
The Planning Commission asked me to prepare on their behalf an application to the State Municipal Planning Grant Program, which is the primary source of planning funds made available to planning commissions and towns. They have had a discussion at one of their meetings about possible projects. I had given them several different ideas. They discussed additional ideas, but they ended up coming down with a project that would come close to meeting one of the priorities, which is work within the designated village areas. There has been for some time recognized in the town plan and in previous policy discussions, there has been recognition of the need to update a study that was done in the year 2000 that looks at parking and transportation issues. So that's what they coalesced on, and so that is what I've begun to work on for the application. The request is for the board to sign a resolution. There is a resolution requirement as part of the application. I would say that the grant funds are limited to $15,000 total. There was an expectation that we would apply for this, so there was match put in the budget. It would be a limited study, and really I think of it as more of a synthesis of studies that have been done in the last 5 or 10 years, but with an update of some pieces of it, because it's not a lot of money. But having said that, it's my understanding that there is also some funding available in connection with the study for the development of the library. And so I believe Joe has suggested this to you so that it would be possible that if we get the funding from the state, it could be used in combination with that, and that the scope could be broadened and or there could be more detailed work done than what's contemplated by the Planning Commission work alone.
Yeah, and I'm sorry, I can't remember if I brought this up in a previous town manager report or not, but the Friends of the Library, which is a separate 501c3, applied for and received, at least we've received indication of a grant. I believe that's going to be about the $30,000 range, and I'm not sure if it's public, so not sure if I can say yet who the foundation is from, but to study transportation related to the new library, if it's in the campus. It would seem more appropriate to kind of combine these monies into one larger project if we can do that. So the motion is worded a little bit funky to give us that flexibility if it's possible. And I'm not sure 100% if it will be possible or not, but it'd be sure be nice to do that. So.
Okay, any comments by anyone? Josh?
I just have a question. Is the match on this, is that a fixed percentage or is it something we just offer?
No, there is a minimum percentage that's required by the program.
It's part of the budget that we put together and passed.
Anything else? Anyone? Yes, please.
Having mistaken this for a prior item, I don't need to repeat my comments. But all the comments I made about the Village Center designation, I'd like now to make about this municipal grant.
Okay.
Apologies to Jeff as well.
Okay. See, it makes me. But I think John. But I think one.
Yeah, we can't all be number one. We can wear the hat, but you know. But I think John's comment applies equally to both, and I think that. The neighborhood groups will greatly appreciate the opportunity to take part.
Indeed. And I will say that part of my own reasons for seeing this synthesis done is because I believe that it can pull together, like I said, a lot of these studies and have the community conversation about some things that might not have had as much community conversation about them when the first reports were developed.
Yeah, exactly. And we appreciate your leadership in this.
Move to approve and execute the proposed resolution for municipal planning grant, and that should the application be funded, the project may be carried out in combination or expanded to include the study of transportation issues conducted as part of the planning for the new library center with grant funds obtained by the Friends of the Pierson Library.
Moved by Colleen, seconded by Jerry. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay.
Easy.
Thanks. Next. Item is item number 15, the number Thurman Munson Ward. Bay Road Corridor Priority Project Update.
All right, I'll quickly summarize what's here. If there's any questions, that's great. So this was a priority project that the board discussed in its April meeting. So we wanted to keep this on as select board agendas every so often to show that we're still paying attention to it. So one, the underpass pilot project. We have been receiving a lot of input. Like I said, equal kind of thumbs up, thumbs down. And there's a public hearing scheduled here for October 25th, whether or not to make that permanent or to go back to the way it was. So you'll deal with that in about a month. We received that grant to study Bay Road and the consulting engineers, I think Ms. Lavalette. Talked to one of them a few weeks ago, have been up and down, and they're going to be putting, and there'll be the design charrette in a month or so, and obviously I'll get the word out about the design charrette and do direct mailings to the folks along Bay Road. The path connecting the fishing access to Ty Hall, so staff, we brush hogged that field and created a path. I found out today that our grant application to the state for some money to do the gravel path was denied. So, you know, either we'll try to do it on our own or figure out something else.
I wouldn't be too concerned about it. With the work that Paul has done to create that 2-foot shoulder on both sides.
I agree.
It's more than adequate, and people are actually using that shoulder and avoiding the grass.
Yeah, we can keep brush hogging instead of, gravel path is probably just not necessary.
Yeah, I wouldn't, I'd take that money and put it somewhere else, to be honest. Yeah. That's.
And on that, the line striping, we've been waiting on the contractor.
They put the yellow down last night.
The yellow's down, then the fog lines will be a little bit narrower also. As before, the guardrail on the bridge we're going to replace as soon as the guy comes to replace it. Hopefully it'll be this fall. It could be early spring. We said we were going to do that. The select board is part of the CIP, and what you want to do, and you can still think about the bridge and if that's going to be back on as a bond ballot item. I've also talked some with representatives of the state of Vermont, gone back and forth about the underpass. Obviously, whether it's single lane or double lane, it's really not an adequate underpass because of the height, the width. We can't get the emergency vehicles there. We all know the story. It's a little bit ambiguous to me still who's responsible for paying for what. It hasn't been cleared 100%. What the railway is responsible for, what the town's responsible, and what the state might be willing to do for either party. So those are questions that still need to be cleared up, and obviously that would be part of a grander plan for Bay Road. All right, that's it, unless there's questions.
I have a couple of comments. I think when we know that there are going to be events at the farm, you know, we need to do some things with, traffic control, I guess is what I'll call it. The Harvest Festival was a good example of that, where it was a 20-minute backup from Route 7 to get to the bridge. So there were a lot of frustrated people coming and going there. So I think that, you know, we just need to take some positive steps there.
We did talk with Shelburne Farms, and certainly, you know, we need to, they don't have events like that all the time, and we can't make policy decisions on kind of one thing every year, but definitely, you know, next year I think we can do some things that will alleviate that, no matter what we do with the underpass area.
Right. So, you know, absolutely. We still have to realize that they see a 500,000 people a year there.
Yep.
So, you know, a lot of people use that route to get there, and it goes without saying, so. Yep, that's good.
All right. Next item is item number 16, update on status of Vermont Rail Litigation from the Select Board Chair. This is going to be extremely brief. We're still involved in litigation. The town received newly discovered evidence recently, and predicated upon that newly discovered evidence, brought a motion in federal court. The railway opposed that motion. And we are waiting to hear from the court. That's it.
Do we have a time frame on that, when that might occur?
Nope.
I asked today, a hearing date hasn't been set. So I don't have any date on that.
All right.
Question?
Sure, run.
So
$219,523.
Correct. So where is that money coming from as a town taxpayer? The budget was $35,000, correct, at the beginning of the budget year?
I can't remember exactly what it was, but it was
30.
I think it was 35.
Okay, so where's the $219 just for the rail, let alone the $300 plus for other litigation within the town? Is that right?
In total.
Total, correct.
Not in addition.
Correct. Right. $200 whatever for the rail, $319.
As we've discussed before, Ron, that came out of our capital reserve fund.
And where does that stand as a percent of the total budget, the total town budget?
I mean, we could answer for the audit that was completed, but the audit that, you know, for the fiscal year that ended June 30th, I think the best I could do is speculate. So, and I wouldn't want to, I mean, we could try to speculate for the next meeting. I wouldn't want to speculate right here, though.
Okay, why don't you figure it out and just include a comment.
We're happy to do that, or even on Friday.
Okay. So if you owned a business and somebody spent 8.6 times more than was budgeted, if one of the commissioners, if the cemetery spent 8.6 times more money than was allotted, what would happen to that board? Or what would be the priority given to that spending, the amount of spending?
You lost me, Ron. What do you?
The cemetery commission's budget is $40,000.
Okay.
If we were to spend 8.6 times more than what was budgeted, which is the legal fee that has been spent versus the $30,000 versus the $310, 8.6, 8.9%, What would happen if you owned a business and somebody spent 8.6 times more than was budgeted? What would be the priority for the board? For anybody? It's not a rhetorical question. Board? Town manager? Anybody?
I don't know where you're going here. I don't understand your question.
You were budgeted, the original budget was, I'll say 35, maybe it was $30,000. The board, the town has spent 310 overall. That's not quite 10 times, 9 times as much as was budgeted. Where does it stop? Where does it stop? If it continues, it's going to continue, right? Where is it going to stop? That's my question. If Paul Goodrich spent 10 times more than he was budgeted, less spreading salt because we had a heavy winter, what would happen?
Well, you know, Rob.
I'm asking.
Okay,
I,
Rob,
I want to know.
I hear your frustration, but you're asking us to reveal litigation strategy right now.
No, I'm not.
Yes, you are.
No,
you're
I'm
asking.
Us,
when is it going to stop? That's a question that is equivalent to when are you going to stop the lawsuit? When are you going to
I'm not asking
walk
that.
Away?
But so that's where what it comes where, down to. Where's the money coming from then?
We've answered
you
that.
You all approve.
We've answered that.
So it's continual. If it goes 20 times more, that's okay. When do you stop? When do you stop spending our money as a taxpayer? I'm serious. When do you stop? I'm asking all of you. All of you.
I can just weigh in on a question that I find quite. I mean, in the town charter, it states that a department can't spend more than its budget without the approval of the select board. The question, I would say, is: are legal expenses considered a department? So it's we have that. That part of the town charter that answers your question, if Paul Bridges spends over his budget, it has to come to the select board. So whether legal expenses fit into that category, I'm not sure. But at least that's my understanding of how these things work.
Joe?
I just
I don't have the charter in front of me. I don't think that that's exactly what it says.
Yeah, I
don't
think so. Go ahead. As
a taxpayer, I'm frustrated. I see no end. And I see what may happen in the end, but I may be totally wrong.
All right. Thank you, Ron.
Thank you. I hope I didn't take too much time.
No. All right. Anyone else? Next item. Item number 17, first reading, traffic ordinance.
I think you can just read it. It's probably quicker to read it.
Just the middle part. The stop sign ordinance amendment?
Yep.
So the Shelburne Select Board hereby ordains that the stop sign ordinance be amended as follows by adding to paragraph 3 westbound and eastbound approaches to the Bay Road Railroad underpass. The effective date of this amendment shall be upon passage, except as amended. The original ordinance adopted July 13th, 1993 shall remain in full force and effect adopted this 25th day of October 2016. Shelburne Select Board. Signed by the members of the select board in the past. All right. Anything, Joe, you want to add to this?
No, this is your public hearing for the 25th on the two-way stop, alternating one lane at Bay Road. And for the October 25th meeting, you'll have data from the traffic engineers, both before and after, and the comments and the whole nine yards.
If you could, for that meeting, I understand many people have contacted you. If you could give, a ballpark figure of,
I think for and against.
Yeah, I think you did that at one time, ballpark-ish.
I would ballpark it at like 60-40, maybe 65-35, 60-44. The way that for the people liking the temporary solution, but it's, people are either kind of 100% for it or 0% for it. There's not much in between. So
can I ask another question?
So the reason we're doing this now is because of the amendment to the ordinance. We have to go through the process of reading it a number of times. I guess I'm puzzled, since we haven't gotten the report that is what will lead to the passage or the consideration and the discussion of the thing. Why do we start the process now? Why wouldn't we wait for the report and then start the ordinance amendment process?
I just thought we could kind of bang out the introduction and the first reading and the second reading without necessarily having all the information, and then by the 25th you'll have all the information. If you don't want to do it that way, we can put it
I'm
back 2 months.
That.
It doesn't.
I'm fine with that.
I mean,
is anybody else prefer not to do it that way, or not follow?
We were going to do a 6 month pilot period, and so right. I wanted to try to stay to that, because if you don't want it to continue, then I mean we don't want to keep the temporary solution there for no reason. But it's whatever the board wants to do. We can rewarn the hearing for a later date.
I like the idea of, you had mentioned it was a 6 month study. It would be nice to try to finish it up in about 6 months.
That's what we're trying to do.
John, Colleen, Jerry, you got thoughts on that?
Well, I think Josh makes a good point, but on the other hand, expediting it, given what we are going to experience in the fall with budget, I'd rather secure as much time for budget as we can. So I think it's a good idea to expedite this and get it going. So much of it is simple notification, but you make a good point.
Colleen and John, do you want to weigh in on this?
Agree with Jerry.
Okay, John.
I'm fine with starting the process.
All right. I think we have our sense. Okay, there's no official action. Anyone have comments? All right, next item up is item number 18. Consider approving a wastewater allocation of 228 gallons per day for 43 Fisher Place. Joey, soon.
I don't think I put this in your packet, but I do think it's online. They paid. It's routine. I recommend approval.
Move to approve a wastewater allocation of 228 gallons per day for 43 Fisher Place.
Moved by Colleen.
Second.
Seconded by Jerry. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed?
This is Bill's project. From the post office.
Yes.
Joe, are we still planning to enter executive session?
Put it on the agenda if you feel like there's
things to do. If not, the board doesn't have to. I'd just put it on there, you know.
I don't see any reason.
Move to our turn.
All right, someone like to
move
to adjourn by Colleen.
Second.
Second by Jerry. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Oh, 8:55.
Wow.
We should be wearing mascots every day if that means we're getting out at 8:55.
Hey, Jeff, how you doing?
Good, how are you?
Good, thanks.
We have to give Gary time enough to get all his junk out of here.
Yeah, well. Thank you.